So the third unit is, we have two parts in your third unit. First part is the algorithms. Unit is divided into two parts. In the first part, we'll discuss what is an algorithm and how to analyze the performance of an algorithm. In the second part, we'll see the mathematical induction. So, can anyone give me the definition for an algorithm? What is the algorithm? Can you tell me what is an algorithm? So algorithm means it is a step-by-step process. Process or set of rules. Step-by-step process, right? So algorithm is, is Nilsar is dealing the subject for you? The design and analysis of algorithm. No. Maybe for AB sections there. Actually, whatever the topics we are going to discuss in this algorithm, all these concepts will come in DS Adda subject now. It will be there in 3-2 for you. In the next year, it will come, right? So, algorithm means it is a step-by-step process. Step-by-step process or set of instructions. We'll be representing the step of instructions in an order to execute a given step, given task. Step-by-step process contains instructions to be executed. Instructions to be executed to perform a task. So that is an algorithm. Generally, you can represent the algorithm in two ways. An algorithm can be represented in two ways. One way of representing the algorithm is, the first way of representing the algorithm is, you will just use a simple English language. You will be using simple English language. For example, in the last class, I explained DFS-BFS algorithm, right? So before I explain the example, I told you the steps, right? What are the steps to be followed to traverse the graph using BFS and DFS, right? So there how I wrote the steps, like define a queue of size equal to number of vertices in the graph. Next, consider any one vertex as your starting vertex, right? So when anyone, those who doesn't have any idea in the computer language, if they see these steps also, they can able to do the task, or they can able to, whatever may be the problem it is, they can able to solve the problem, right? So that is one way of the, so here I can also call this as an algorithm also. Why? Because algorithm means it contains the step-by-step process, or it will give you the steps to be followed. Which step is to be performed at what time? What is the first one? What is the second step? So the step-by-step process it is giving. Using this step-by-step process, you are able to perform BFS or DFS. Therefore, I can call it as an algorithm, but it is using a simple English language sentences. Simple English language it is using. Let us consider, suppose if your problem is find the maximum element in a sequence of numbers. Or in a series of numbers. You have some set of numbers and you have to find the maximum element in that set. So using the first way of representing the algorithm, how you will write? First, you have a sequence of numbers, right? First, how you will perform? First, you will consider this first element as the maximum element, right? So you will select the first element in the series, as a temporary maximum element. Temporary maximum element. So first of all, you'll be considering a temporary value and you are equating it to the maximum value. First element, you are equating it as a temporary and you are considering it as a maximum element. Next, what you will do? You will move on to the next element. So you keep on moving to the next element, and next element is compared with the first element. Next element is compared with the first element. If the next element is maximum, then what you will be doing? You will be equating the, you will be initializing your temporary to the second element. To the second element. The maximum element is the second element. Okay? Like that, how you will do? Like that, you will visit or you will traverse all the elements. You will visit all the elements in the sequence. Right? That means you will visit the last element, right? So whichever is the maximum element, that will be your maximum element in the group of sequence. Right? Now I'm not concentrating on the process now. Here you just observe the English language what I'm writing. So whenever anyone observe this language, they can able to find the maximum element in the series also. Why? Because I'm just using the simple English language. Right? I can. There is one more way to represent the algorithm. There is another way to represent an algorithm which acts like an intermediate step between the English language and the programming language. Second way of representing the algorithm, and this is known as pseudocode. We'll call it as pseudocode. This pseudocode is an intermediate step between the simple English language and the programming language. Suppose if you are asked you to find the maximum element in a group of series using the C language, you will be writing one program, right? But those who have an idea on C language, they can only understand that, right? But those who doesn't have idea on the C programming language, they can't do, right? So whatever may be the programming language, right? So before you write the program for a given problem, you will be writing one pseudo code that will, and we are not writing it in a simple language as we are computer science student. So you are not supposed to write it in a simple language, right? So you have to write it in pseudocode, where the pseudocode is something like the raw element. It is something like the raw element or the raw material. Suppose you will have some raw material to construct something, right? So the pseudocode is also like the raw element or the raw material for the programming language, right? So this pseudocode will contain everything. Something like what are the variables you are using, what are the operations you are using, what are you going to return, everything, what are the operation you are going to perform, everything will be returning in the pseudocode, and you just need to arrange them with the proper syntax with corresponding to C language. Suppose if I am implementing this algorithm in a C language, you will be using the syntax of C language. If I am implementing in a Java programming, you will be using the syntax of the Java program, but the raw material will be here. Something like, you know, illu kattalanukomma, the raw material will be there. Something like bricks, sand, cement, everything will be there, right? But neeku nachinatlaga you will be constructing using that raw material. Same thing here also, you will have pseudocode as a raw material and you will be constructing into the corresponding programming language, or you will be arranging, or you will be writing it in a proper syntax. Clear? That is what a pseudocode means. So we have seen how by using the simple English language how to write the algorithm to find the maximum element in a series. Now we will see the pseudocode, that is the second representation. We'll see the pseudocode for finding the maximum element in a series or in a list. So how you will write is procedure means the name of the algorithm. So procedure. What is the procedure you are writing? You are writing sound kadhi chup. Phone ke ko. You will be writing the procedure for or algorithm for finding the maximum element. You just give a name to the procedure. You can give a name to the procedure, right? And what I am going to have, my list, in the list, I am going to have some n number of elements. All are integers. I'll be having n number of elements in the list, all are of integers, right? So this procedure is the algorithm, something like the algorithm. Next, first what I'll do, I'll equate the first element as a maximum element. I'll consider the first element as a maximum element, right? Next, so generally equating means you will write, you will just use the equal symbol, right? But in algorithm, you have to write colon followed by equal. That means maximum is equal to A1. Next, for I is equal to, that means from the next element, you starting from the second element to the nth element, you have to move forward and you have to check with every element whether that is maximum or not, right? So first, I is equal to 2 to N. For loop, you will write like this. If it is a C language, how you will write? I is equal to 2, I less than N, I plus plus, right? So that all that we'll be writing like this in case of a algorithm, pseudocode. For I is equal to 2 to N, start, that means I is equal to 2, I less than N, I plus plus up to N, increment up to N. If maximum, that means maximum element you have considered, it can be the first element, second element. If it is second element, you will compare it with the third element. If it is third, maximum is third element, you will compare it with the fourth element. If maximum is AI, AI means I is the location. AI means it can be first element, second element, third element, like that. If maximum is AI, then if maximum is less than AI, then that means what? This element is the largest element. So if I minus 1, if you have assumed that in the first step, you have assumed I minus 1th element as your maximum. Next, you will compare it with the ith element. If the ith element is maximum, then you have to equate the maximum to ith element, right? AI is your maximum. And this should be repeated for all the elements in the list. So, in this way, you will write this pseudo code for a given task. Is it clear, ma'am? Is it clear? So one way of writing the algorithm is you can use a simple language, but as a computer science student, you should not follow that. So second way is you can use the pseudocode as an intermediate step between the programming language and the simple English language. Clear? Now, we'll see what are the properties of an algorithm. Properties of an algorithm. First one is, every algorithm should have an input values, should be supplied with some input values. Every algorithm should be supplied with an input values. That is the first property. And by using these input values, every algorithm should produce an output. In the last place, I have given A1 to A2 AN. This list I have given as an input, right? Without input, it cannot produce output. So input should be provided and it will produce what is the maximum element. That will be your output. So every algorithm must be supplied with an input and it should produce the output. Third property of an algorithm is it should be definite. It should be definite. Definite means every step of an algorithm first be defined properly. Each step of an algorithm must be defined properly. You have to define each and every step properly. Whatever the steps you require to perform a given task, every step should be defined properly for an algorithm. Next is correctness. Correctness means an algorithm should produce the correct output. It has to produce. Second point is what? It should be in a position. The algorithm must provide or produce the output, but that output should be correct. Suppose if you are written an algorithm to perform A plus B and you have supplied the input values as 2 plus 3. You know that 2 plus 3 is 5. So whenever you are performing this task, the addition of these two numbers using the algorithm what I have written, it has to produce the same output 5 because it is correct. So correct output should be produced. The algorithm should be produced. You have to write the algorithm such a way that it has to produce the correct output. Right? Input, output, definiteness and correctness. Next property is finiteness. Finiteness means whatever the algorithm you write. So the algorithm has to produce the output after executing finite number of steps. The number of steps can be 100, or the algorithm may contain 50 steps, or the algorithm may contain 10 steps. If the algorithm contains 100 steps, after 100 steps, it has to produce the output. Compulsory, it has to give the output. After finite number of steps, the algorithm must produce the output. Clear, that is what the finiteness means. It should be finite in producing the output. The number of steps should be finite in producing the output. Next is effectiveness. Effectiveness. Effectiveness means after performing each step of an algorithm should be performed after a finite amount of time. Should be performed in a finite amount of time. So see the difference between these two. Effectiveness means every step should be performed or every step should give the result. Execution of the third step may depend on the execution of the second step. Execution of the second step may depend on the first step, right? So if you want to execute the second step, you have to complete the first step in a finite amount of time, right? Every step should take finite amount of time and should give the result. Finiteness means you are talking about the complete algorithm. Every algorithm has to produce the output. So here it is the output, here it is, you are talking about the intermediate result. Intermediate result. And the last property is generality. Generality. Generality means whatever the algorithm you are writing, that algorithm should be applicable for all the problems. Let us suppose if I am writing an algorithm to perform sum of two numbers. I have written an algorithm to perform sum of two numbers. Okay? So when you have written this algorithm, this algorithm you can apply on any input values to add. I can apply on 2 plus 3. I can apply on any values 3 plus 7. I can apply on 6 plus 8. So the same algorithm you can apply on any input and it has to give. The same algorithm should produce the exact or the correct output. So, if this algorithm is not giving the result, if not giving the correct result for this, let us suppose by using this algorithm, by taking another input, some other set of input values, if you are getting the wrong output, then whatever the algorithm you have written is not a valid algorithm or not correct. Right? Generality means whatever you have written, that should be applied for all the input values, for all set of input values. Is it clear, ma? These are the properties of an algorithm. Clear? Now, next we will see some of the algorithm for some differential problems. We'll see how to write the algorithm. Let us see the algorithm for linear search. Linear search. Algorithm. You know how to perform the linear search, right? So, in the given list of elements, starting from the first element, you will search. Let us suppose X is the element you are looking for. And the list contains A1, A2, A3, so on up to AN. Okay? Then what you will do? You will compare the element X with A1. You will compare X with A2, X with A3. Like that, you will compare the element X with the AN. Right? So, for which element X is matched, that will be your result. Or that location will be the result. Where, in which location it is present, if you are asked, then you have to write the location. Clear? So, see how you will write the algorithm for this linear search. Procedure. Procedure means, what is the procedure I am writing? I am writing a procedure. Or what is the algorithm you are writing? I am writing an algorithm for linear search operations. Linear search. And this linear search contains, the element X is the element you are looking for. X is the element you are looking for. And the set contains A1 to AN. All are integers. Okay? So, you have to define the elements like this. Clear? Linear search, I am writing a procedure for linear search algorithm where it contains the input as one list of integers and one element that you are looking for. So, you have to search whether X is present in the list or not. Right? No. Initially, you will equate i is equal to 1. Now, while I less than or equal to n, and X is not equal to it, if this condition is true, that means you are searching every element in the list. So, let us suppose initially your I will be the first element, right? So, that means AI, 1 is less than or equal to N. N is the last element and X is not equal to A1. That means if the element you are looking for is not present in the first location, 1 means the first location, then you have to increment your I, right? If this condition is true, increment the I value. Increment I is equal to I plus. Now I becomes 2. A2. Then I becomes A2. So increment the I value. If I less than or equal to N. If I less than or equal to N. And when you are incrementing this, then location is equal to I. Then the location is equal to I. So, whenever this condition is satisfied, you will keep on incrementing the I value. If this condition is failed, that means X not equal to, suppose I, you consider you have incremented I to 1, first initially it is 1, next you have incremented 2, 3, what should it be? 5. You will increment to 5. Now, whenever your I value is 5, at that time, if this condition fails, that means and I have used means both are to be satisfied. So, I is, assume that n equal to 10. 10 number of elements were there in your list. So, 5 is not equal to 10. Yes, this condition is satisfied. But, so here, at 5th location, whatever the element you are looking for is present. Assume like that, right? So, X not equal to A5 is not correct. That means, X equal to A5. This is true. At 5th location, this x element is present, that means if this condition is satisfied, if this condition is not satisfied, that means if it is false, then you can write the location. You can write the location. So I should be less than or always should be less than or equal to n, then your location will be I. That means phi will be your location. Else location is 0. Else the location is 0. Location is equal to 0 means what? The element is not found in the list. The element is not present in the list. Here, ma, in this way you will write the algorithm for linear search operation. Clear? Understood? Similarly, suppose if you consider binary search operation. So binary search means what? How you will perform the binary search? So in the binary search, you will have ordered list. The list will be in the increasing order, or you can say ascending order. Ascending order list will be given to you. And in that ascending order list, you have to search for the element you want. Search for the element you want. Okay. Now, as you are having a list in the ascending order, right? So, what you will be doing is, your given list, first you will divide it into two halves. You will divide the given list into two halves. Something like, let us suppose if you have the elements like 1, 2. In the ordered list you have. In the ordered list you are having the elements, right? Now what I can do is, I will divide the list into half. First you have to find the middle position and divide it into two halves, right? Now you will either check, look, or you will either search in the right part or you will search in the right left part. If it is a linear search, starting from the first element, you have to search till the last element. If your last element may present in the last position, if the element you are looking for is present in the last position, you have to traverse or you have to visit all the vertices, right? But which will take more time. To avoid that, you will be using the binary search algorithm. So what you will be doing here, you will divide it into half. Now assume that if your the element you are looking for is 7, then you will compare this x with the last element of this, the last element in the first part, the last element in the second first part you can compare, or you can compare it with the first element in the second part. You can compare x with 5. You can compare x with 5, which is the last element in the left part. Or you can compare x with 6, which is the first element. First element in the right part, right? So, suppose if I am considering this. If the element you are looking for, if the element you are looking for is less than or equal to 5, then I traverse the left part. If the element... Otherwise, you traverse the boundary. Otherwise, you traverse the right part. Clear? So, let us see how to write the algorithm for this. Clear? Procedure, I am writing a procedure for binary search. I am looking for an x is the element I am looking for, and the list contains a1 to an, and all these elements are there in the increasing order. We have the elements in the increasing order. Now i is equal to 1, so I is the left end point of this search traversal. I is the left end point. And j is equal to n. J is the right end part. J is the right end part. first what you have to do? You have to divide the list into two halves. So how you can divide? Until and unless you know the first element or the last element. Until you know how many elements were present. So if I is equal to 1, j is equal to 10. That means 10 elements were there. So you can divide it into fifth location. Or you can divide it into middle by considering middle element as 5. So that is the reason you are taking I as the first element in the left part, j as the right part. Now, why I less than j, this is satisfied, then you divide the list into two halves. M is the middle element. Middle element is equal to I plus j by 2. You divide it into two halves. Now, after dividing the list into two halves, you will be checking where your element is present. If the element you are looking is greater than AM, is greater than AM, that means greater than means what? It is present in the right part. M is the middle element, right? So the element you are looking for is greater than this. AM means greater than the middle element. Then it is present in the right part. So you have to traverse the right part. So increase the middle element value. M should be increased to M plus 1. Then M plus 2. Like that you will compare. Right? If this condition is not satisfied, that means it is present in the left part. Else J is equal to M. Okay? And end the process. Next, you just write where the location, where it is present. If x is equal to ai, then location is equal to I. Then location is equal to I. Otherwise, location is 0. That means the element is not present. Then this. Clear, ma'am? Have you understood? Have you understood now? We have to compare the middle value. We have to. Sometimes the x will be directly found. Then before then, if that is the case, before you have to write it. X equal to AM, then location is equal to M. Three conditions you will have, right? X equal to AM, then location equal to M. It is greater, move to the right. Otherwise, move to the left. Clear? 520. One second. 520. Clear. Listen here. Here, this should not be there. Why? Because what we are doing, you are dividing it into two parts. Middle element means you will find the middle position. Middle position, suppose if the middle position is 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 will be at the left end, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 will be on the right side. The middle position you are finding. So I to M will present in the left part, M plus 1 to J will present in the right part. So middle element will not be there. Middle element will not be there. You will either include that middle element into the left part or you can include in the right part. Is it clear? So only this condition will be satisfied. You will not have this condition. That means you will check with AM. Suppose if I have included this middle element in the left part. In the left part, then you will compare. If this condition is not satisfied, then you will move to the right part. M plus 1 to location you are moving. You are moving with to M plus 1 to location. Clear now? 520. Have you understood?
Yeah.
Okay. The last algorithm is, see how you will write the bubble sort algorithm. What exactly is bubble sort? Suppose if the list contains 3, 2, 4, 1, 5 other elements. This list contains the elements like 3, 2, 4, 1, 5, right? So how you will perform bubble sort now? First you will compare the first two elements, right? If the second element is less, then you will just exchange them. Then it becomes 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 5. Next you will compare 3, 4. Yes, they are in the order. So you will move to the next two. Next 3, 4, and 5. Next you will compare 4, 1. So here you have to swap these two. Then it becomes 2, 3, 1, 4, 5. And then you have to perform 4, 5. Yes, they are in the order. So this is first iteration. This complete is the first iteration. In the second iteration, repeat the same process. So, now you have 2, 3, 1, 4, 5, right? So, here the condition is satisfied. They are in the order. Next, you will compare 2, 3 and 1. They are not in the order, so you just swap them. Then it becomes 2, 1, 3, 4, 5. Next, you compare 3, 4. Yes, they are in the order. Then you compare 3, 4, 5. Yes, they are also in the order. This is your second iteration. And you have to repeat it until you get the, all the elements in the order. Now you have 2, 1, 3, 4, 5. 2, 1, 3, 4, 5. This is your third iteration. These are not in the order. So you just tap them. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Next you will compare 2, 3. Next you will compare 3, 4. Next to 4, 5. As they are in the order, so you can start the procedure. Let's see how to write the algorithm for this Bubble Sort algorithm. The procedure I am writing is for bubble sort. The bubble sort contains the list from AN to AN. For I is in, so you have to compare the first element and the last element, right? Sorry, second element. So I will be the first element. And J will be the second element. Let us assume. Then you will compare A, I and A. So this is for the iteration. I is for the iteration. J is for comparing the elements. So J is equal to 1 to I minus I. Next, what you have to do, you need to compare A, J. If AJ and AIJ plus 1 you have to compare. AJ and AJ plus 1 you will compare. If AJ is greater than, that means if the first element is greater than the second element, you interchange them or you swap AJ and AJ plus 1. So this is, you have to repeat this step for all the iterations. Then you will get the elements in the increasing order. Okay. So this is how you will write the algorithms for any given problem. And the next concept in this is growth of function, or you can say growth of an algorithm. Or growth of algorithms, you can see. Right? So, to estimate the growth of the function, you can use three notations. To estimate the growth of an algorithm, three notations can be used. First notation is big O notation. You will represent with the O. Next, omega notation. And the next is theta notation. Theta notation. So these are the three notations you can use. So let us see, mostly you won't get any problems from this mark. So let me give you the definitions of these. So assume that if f, comma g are the two functions, f and g are the two functions, or you can say f of x and g of x are the two functions, then you can say that f of x is order of g of x. You can say f of x is order of g of x for constant value c comma k, for two constant c comma c, such that the condition f of x less than or equal to c into g of x is satisfied. Okay, c is a constant and x should be greater than k. F of x and g of x are the two functions, then you can say that f of x is order of g of x. I'll give you some simple example for this. For constant c and k, when this condition is satisfied, then you can say f of x is g of x. You can write f of x equal to order of g of x only when this condition is satisfied. So when you observe this condition, f of x is less than or equal to g of x, that means f of x should be the small value and g of x is the greater value. Okay? So I'll give you the definitions for the remaining two, then I'll give you one simple example to understand how. Next is, for big O notation, what is the condition to be satisfied? For big O notation, f of x should be less than or equal to c into g of x. Okay? Next, for omega notation, f of x should be greater than or equal to c into g of x. Then you can say that f of x is equal to omega of g of x. Here, you can say f of x is equal to order of g of x. Next, theta notation. F of x should be equal to c into g of x. Equal to c into g of x. Then you can say that f of x is equal to theta of g of x. One second. So let me give you one small example. Suppose if you have a value 2.2. So assume that this is your f, right? So big O notation will always give you the upper limit. Omega notation will give you the lower limit. And theta notation will give you the equal, exact value, you can say. So, if f of x is equal to g of x, then you can say that the g of x value is something like 3. Or you can say it is 2.8, assume that. Then, 3. You will consider the bigger value or the upper value of 2.8 is what? 3. So, in big O notation, you will always consider the maximum value or the upper value you will consider. So, it is big O notation. In big O notation, f of x is equal to 2.8, you will consider this as 3. The upper limit or upper value of 2.8 is 3. In omega, you will consider the lower value, that means you will consider 2. In theta, the exact value you will consider, that is 2.8 you will consider. Clear? No? So, big O notation will always give you the upper limit omega notation will give you the small lower limit and theta notation will give you the exact limit. Okay? So generally most of the cases you will be using in, after this we'll discuss complexity, that means time complexity, space complexity we'll see. Right? So for all the notation maximum you will be using bigger notation only. Maximum value, bigger notation will always give you the upper value, right? So for 2.83 is the correct, I mean upper value, right? So you will always consider upper values only, right? So bigger notation will be used for all the complexities. Mostly you will use bigger notation, yeah? Suppose if you have a function f of x is equal to x squared plus 2x plus 1. So if you are asked you to find, prove that, show that f of x is equal to so and so function given is order of x square, order of x square. Here what is the upper value? The maximum coefficient mark? X square is the maximum value, right? When you compare x square with 2x and 1, x square is the greatest value, right? So always the upper value or the greatest value will be your order for the given function. Therefore, this function you can represent it as order of x square. Suppose if you have a function like f of x equal to 2x plus 1. When you compare this 2x and 1, the bigger value is 2x. Therefore, you can call it as order of x. This function is equal to order of x. That means this function varies. The value of this function varies depending on the value of x. The value of this mostly depends on the value of x square. Why? Because it is the maximum value. Suppose if f of x is equal to some 5, then it is order of 1. You can say order of 1. Order of 1 means it is constant. Order of ones, it is a constant. Clear? Yes, understood? Have you understood? Next is the complexity of algorithms. In another terms, you can say the performance of algorithm or the analysis of algorithm. So always an algorithm can be analyzed by taking two things into mind. One is consider the space complexity and considering the time complexity. You'll always analyze the performance of your algorithm. How efficient is your algorithm? An algorithm is efficient if it takes less space and less time. Clear? So space complexity means it is related to the memory space in the computer. How much of memory space is required to store all the variables and whatever the variables you have in your algorithm, to store all those values, how much memory space is required. Time complexity is in how much time you are able to get the output. Okay? So you can say that your algorithm is efficient if it requires less space and it gives the output in less amount of time or in early. So always the efficiency of an algorithm depends on the space complexity and the time complexity. Yeah. Let's see even examples on this. So first we'll see the space complexity. So generally the space complexity One second. So the space complexity means amount of the space required for an algorithm. How much space required for an algorithm. So here, this space, three categories of space can be occupied by the algorithm. An algorithm will occupy three categories of the space. First category of the space is, it requires space for instructions. When you remember your COA, there you will be, you'll have data registers and the instruction register. Register means it is some memory space only, right? Register means it's a memory space, okay? So data register will store the data values, instruction register will store the instructions, right? Suppose if you have the instructions, something like for loop, for I is equal to 1 to n, this is one instruction, right? So if you declare some a, b values, then these are your data values, right? So you have to store a, b values, I values and the instruction for also, right? Instruction will be storing in this instruction register, data in the data register. So amount of, when you are talking about the total space required for a memory, sorry, for an algorithm, then this space, three categories of the space will be occupied by any of the algorithm. So algorithm will require instruction space, that means space to store the instructions present in the algorithm. An algorithm will require data space. And the last one is, algorithm will require environment space. Now, you can say interface space. Environment or class. So, these three categories of the space are required for any algorithm. Instruction space, data space, and the environment space. So, the space complexity, we have two categories of the space complexity. One is constant space complexity, constant space complexity, and the second type of the space complexity is linear space complexity. Linear space complexity, two types of space complexities we have. Constant space complexity and linear space complexity. Wait for 2 minutes, ma. I'll just come. So two types of space complexities we have, constant space complexity and linear space complexity. So constant space complexity. If your constant space complexity means, if you are program or if your algorithm contains some fixed number of steps, then constant space complexity will be used. Or constant space complexity means it is some fixed value or fixed amount of space you will get. So fixed number of steps were present. suppose let me give you an algorithm, simple algorithm. So procedure, assume that the procedure name is something like ABC, right? So you will be taking one integer and return P plus P, right? So when you observe this algorithm here, this algorithm, I can call it contains, I can say that this algorithm contains for fixed number of steps, right? The number of steps are fixed. So only one. So only one step is there. Therefore, you can say that it is a constant space. It requires some constant space. So this, how much space is required for this algorithm? Can you tell me how much space is required for an algorithm? So this algorithm will require the space to store this p value. So this requires the space to store the input value p. So which is constant. It won't change repeatedly. It won't change repeatedly. Okay? So this type of algorithms requires constant space. The algorithms which contain some fixed number of steps require some constant space. Clear, ma? Yes, is it? Have you understood? When, amma? Suppose linear space complexity means the algorithm contains variable number of steps. Linear space complexity. So if the algorithm contains something like procedure, if your algorithm contains some arrays, some for loops, while loops, repeated loops, if you are having loops, arrays, if you are having in your algorithm, then it requires linear space. The space is required is a linear space, right? So if you have only one variable, you require only one unit of space. Only one. I am not talking about the space value. It can be a kb, or it can be mb, or it can be gb, whatever it is. I am just talking about the units, right? So if you have only a single variable, if you have only variable, all the variables will require only one unit of time. Clear? Suppose if you have an array of size n, then this requires n units of time. Array will require n units of time. If you have a loop also, then the loop, how many times that loop is repeated, those many units of time, those many units of space you require. If it is a loop, how many times it is repeating, those many you require. Is it clear, ma? In case of a constant space, you will have the algorithm itself is fixed. You don't have all these arrays and the loops. You will have only the variable. So how much space is required for the variable? Only that is sufficient. Suppose if you consider an algorithm like here, if you have an array, this is your array, which contains the main variables, right? And some for loops, if I am using some for loops, let us suppose if you have an algorithm like this, right? Now here when you observe here, you have some fixed statements and you have some loops and you have an array also, right? So how much space is required for this, ma? How much space you require for this? So for initialization of these variables, you require one unit of time, right? So you have to initialize I and sum. So one for I, one for sum. the 2 units of space you require. And here you are having an array of size n. So you require n units of time. You have an array of size n, so n units of time is required. And here here when you consider this for loop, this for loop is repeating for n number of times. Every time the I value, you are taking only one location for I, and that initially it will be 0, but the next iteration the I value can be 1, and in the next iteration I value will be 2. But so how much space this for loop is occupying now? Can you tell me how much space this for loop is occupying? Only the space required for I is sufficient. Why? Because every time it is updating, you are not storing the previous values of I. Initially, if I is equal to 0, after that, if you increase I equal to I plus 1, it will change to 1. And you are not storing the previous value. When you again perform I equal to I plus 1, you are not storing the previous value. So, only how much space you require for I, that is one unit of time, one unit of space. Right? Only that much of space is required. When you talk about the time will vary. Why? Because it is repeating for n number of times. So, n units of time it requires. But here, space complexity, you will talk about the time. So, for loop also, for this for loop also, you require only one unit of time. One unit of time is required. Clear, ma? Again, here, this sum also, this is sum. Sum equal to sum plus A of I, whatever I have written. So, sum value you are updating. Initially, it is 0. Initially, it is 0. So, let me write it here clearly. How many variables you are using here? I is one variable. So, you require space. One unit of space for I, and sum is another variable, so you require one more unit of space, and you are using one array. Array means n words are there. Suppose if n elements were there, n units of space you require for this array, n unit, and one more is your return. And so total of this n plus 2 units of time you require. Clear, ma? So in this way, linear space complexity will be calculated. So constant space complexity means there you have only fixed number of statements, some like fixed variables you will have. So only the space required for those variables is the space complexity of that algorithm. Linear space complexity is applicable for an algorithm which contains a variable number of steps, something like loops, arrays, and everything. So, if you have an algorithm of that type, then you have to consider what are the variables present in the algorithm, what are the loops, how many loops you have, how many arrays you have, what is the size of the array, everything you have to consider in calculating the space complexity. Is it clear, ma? Have you all understood? Have you all understood what I explained? If you have any doubts, please let me. Okay. Next, I'll tell you how to find the time complexity. Wait for a while, I'll explain. Next is the time complexity. So time complexity is the time required to execute the program. The time required. How much of time it requires. The time required to execute the program is called the time complexity. So generally, this time complexity can be calculated using frequency count method. using frequency count method, you can find the time complexity. Okay, so let me give you one example for this. Consider an algorithm. Algorithm is sum of a comma n. S is equal to 0 initially for I is equal to 1 to n. I is equal to 1 to n. S is equal to S plus A of I. Return S. So here these are the statements in the algorithm. So using this frequency count method, first of all, you will be identifying how many steps were there in the algorithm or how many statements were there in the algorithm, and each statement is repeating for how many times. That frequency also you should know using by knowing the number of steps and the frequency of these steps, you can find the time complexity, right? So here I'll be writing how many steps you are executing, how many number of steps you can write. Next, how many times each step is repeating, that frequency you will write, right? Suppose if you have only one step and if that step is repeating for n times, how much time it requires marks to execute that instruction? N into 1 or 1 into 1. So total time required is always equal to steps into number of steps into on the frequency count. Clear? So here I'll be writing the total. Let me divide this algorithm into statements or in steps. So how many steps you have? Let me divide it into clear? So these are the steps marked. First one is what? Are you executing anything here? You are not executing. So number of steps are zero. There is no frequency. Number of steps itself are zero. So the frequency is zero. So total time is always zero. Here also you are not executing anything. You are not executing anything. So the frequency is nothing. Now, how many instructions you are executing here? How many you are executing here? How many instructions you are executing here? Only one instruction, that is initializing a zero value to yes. So number of instructions I am executing are one. How many times this you are doing? How many times you are initializing? I am initializing for only one time. So the frequency for this instruction is one. So the total time required for this initialization is the total time will be one. Now here, how many statements you have my for loops? How many for loops you are having here? One for loop here. Now see here. And this for loop you are repeating for n plus 1 times. First I is equal to 1, next I is equal to 2, I is equal to 3, and I is equal to n. You'll check for I equal to 1. And you will also check for I equal to n plus 1. If this is false, then you will come out of this loop. Whenever this is true for all I is equal to 1 to n, the followed steps will be executed, but you will repeat this for loop for I is equal to n plus 1 also for false condition. For checking the false condition, you will repeat the for loop. Therefore, total of how many times you are repeating this for loop? This is only one step. For loop is only one step, but that for loop you are repeating for n plus 1 times. N plus 1 times, right? So total time required is n plus 1 into 1, that is n plus 1. Now coming to this yes. So this yes is when this condition is satisfied, when this for loop is satisfied. For I is equal to 1, it will be repeated. For I is equal to n also, it is repeated. For I equal to 2. But when I is equal to n plus 1, it will come out of this for loop, right? And it will return the value. That means this is only one step. S equal to S plus A is only one step, but this one step is repeated for all the true values of I. Whenever I equal to 2, for all the true values of I, it will be repeated. How many times this for loop is true? This for loop will be true for I is equal to 1 to N. That means it is true for N. whenever it is false, you will check the for loop for n plus 1 also, but when it is false, you will not execute this. You will come out of this. So that is the reason for loop. For this statement, for loop, the frequency is n plus 1. For this statement, the frequency is n. So total time required to execute this instruction is n unit of time. I'm not concentrate. I'm not bothering about the time. It can be hours, n hours, or n minutes, or n seconds, or n microseconds. But I'm just telling you the units of time. Next, for return statement, it is one only. Only one return statement, and this will be returned for only one false condition. So false condition will be checked for only one time. So the frequency is always one. Right? Now there is nothing. Nothing you are executing, and the frequency is nothing. So when you add all these, you will get the total time complexity. N plus 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1. That is 2n plus 1. 2n plus 3 is the time complexity. Or you can write it as the time complexity. If f of x is, if of f of n is equal to 2n plus 3, then you will write it as order of n. Why? Because the maximum value is 1. So the time complexity for this algorithm is order of n, you can say. Is it clear, ma? Yes, have you all understood? అర్థమైందమ్మా? సో ఇన్ దిస్ వే you can find the or you can analyze the performance of an algorithm using the space complexity and time complexity, right? So space complexity you will analyze by using the constants. It can be either constant space complexity or linear space. If your algorithm is simple and contains only some fixed number of variables and fixed number of steps, then you will get constant space complexity. If it is variable, you there you have to consider the space required for loops, for arrays, for variables, whatever you are taking, for everything you have to consider the space. If it is a time complexity, number of units of time you require. So there you, by using the frequency count method, you will analyze what are the steps we have in the algorithm, how many times, the frequency of each step you have to analyze and find the total time. Clear, ma? Give me 5 minutes of time, I'll just come, ma. Wait for 5 minutes. So this is about algorithms. Now we'll see mathematical induction. So what is this mathematical induction? What exactly is induction? Suppose if you have a ladder, suppose if you are having a ladder with infinite number of steps, you don't know how many steps were there in the ladder. So if you want to climb this ladder, so if you want to reach the top of the ladder, I want to reach the top of the ladder. So, can I reach this top of the ladder or not? Can I reach or not? How to know whether I can reach this or not? So, to know that, first you have to consider whether you are able to reach the first step of the ladder. First step, generally we'll call it as rungs. We call them as rungs. Okay. So if you are able to reach the first rung, then you can say that I can reach the second rung. Ante kadamma nenu ikkada vachinanante ikkada velthanu ikkade undi. I cannot say that I can reach the top rung of the ladder. Okay. I can only say that the next rung I can reach. Similarly, if I am on the first rung, I can say that I can reach the second rung. If I am on the second rung, I can say that third. Like that, if n steps were there or n rungs were there, if you are or if you reach n minus 1 rungs, then you can say that I can reach the nth rung. If I reach the nth rung, means what? You can reach the ladder, the top of the ladder. Okay? So this technique is called mathematical induction. In the same way, when a sequence is given, if that equation, whatever the equation is given, if that is true for first value, then that will be true for the next one. Something like 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus so on up to n. Sum of the n numbers equal to n into n plus 1 by 2. Right? You know that it is true. But how you will prove that? You can prove that this condition, it is true for p of for n equal to 1. If it is true for n equal to 1, then you will check it is true for n equal to k also. If it is true for n equal to k, then it must be true for n equal to k plus 1. Am I clear, ma? Whenever any equation is given, first you will check whether it is true for, that means are you able to reach the first rung or not? First rung reach avanappudu ninkedi reach avalevu, right? If it is true for the n equal to 1, then you will check middle ekkada oka dan value check chestam. Is it true for n equal to k? If n equal to k, if it is true for n equal to k, it should be true for, it will be true for n equal to k plus 1 also. So for any of the value, if it is true, then you can say that whatever the equation you have considered is true. And this can be proved, these type of equations, you can prove them using the mathematical induction method, right? So this involves two steps. So this principle of mathematical induction, the principle of this mathematical induction involves in two steps. One is, suppose if I want to prove that P of n is equal to true, I want to prove that P of n is any given equation is true, whatever the equation I gave you, you may consider that, right? If I want to prove that P of n equal to true, using this mathematical induction, you can prove this P of n by using two steps or by using two assumptions, right? First step is known as basis step. First step is known as basis step. Second step is known as inductive step. Inductive step. Basis step means you will prove that the equation is true for n equal to 1. That means you will prove that, or you will check whether P of n is true or not. If yes, then you will move to the inductive step. Inductive step means what? You will show that if P of k is true, then P of k plus 1 is also true. Am I clear, ma'am? First, we'll check whether you can able to reach first rung or not. If yes, you will check whether you can able to reach k plus 1 rung or not. That can be any value. K plus 1 can be any value, right? So, ante meeting lo ekkadaina k plus 1 isthunna anko ma. So, if you have already reached k rung, then you can reach k plus 1 rung. This you need to prove. If these two steps are proved or verified, then you can say that P of N is true. If basis step and inductive step are verified, then you can say that P of N, the given equation, is true. Is it clear? Is the concept is clear? If yes, I'll explain an example. Have you understood, ma'am? Now let us see one example on this mathematical induction. Show that or prove that. Same, consider 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus so on up to n. Sum of the first n integer natural number is equal to n into n plus 1 by 2. You know that you will be using this as a formula, right? But using this mathematical induction, you have to prove whether this formula is correct or not. Ma'am, use just the number. Correct kada nippana check chesamma. You didn't do that. Now we will check. So, how you will check? First, we will check what is the basis step. Using the two steps, you will verify this, right? First one is the basis step. Second one is the inductive step. Okay? What is the basis step? Basis step means we will verify whether it is true for P of 1. Whether it is true for P of 1. So, P of 1 means what? N equal to 1. N equal to 1 means LHS side you will have only 1. Ante kada ma? Only okati element untu. On the right hand side, RHS side, yeah, 1 into 1 plus 1 by 2. So 2 get cancelled, then you will get 1 is equal to 1. So this kind, if you consider the sum of natural numbers as this formula, you have proved that it is true for 1, for N equal to 1. Basis step is verified. Next one is the inductive step. Let me write in a fresh page. Inductive step means what? So you will, we assume that P of K is 2. P of K is 2. If P of K is true, then we'll prove that it is true for P of K plus 1 also. P of K is 2 means what? Your equation will be like this. 1 plus 2 plus 3 so on up to K is equal to K into K plus 1 by 2. Right? Now, using this assumption, I'll consider P of K plus 1. I'll consider that this is true for P of K plus 1 also. Because it is true for P of K means it is true for P of K plus 1. That means if you are able to reach kth rung, you can reach K plus 1 rung. Right? So now it becomes 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus so on up to K plus 1 is equal to wherever you have K, you just substitute K plus 1 there. Then you will have K plus 1 into K plus 1 plus 1, that is K plus 2 by 2. You will prove that. You will prove this now. So this is P of K plus 1. This is P of K, right? Now you consider this P of K. Consider this P of K. Then what you will get to this P of K, if you add K plus 1 on both the sides, then you will get 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus so on up to K. On both the sides, I am adding k plus 1. Why? Because I am just checking whether this is at. Is it true one in true chesan? Using the basis step. Using the first step, I have proved that, or I can say that I can reach kth rung. Now, if I can reach kth rung, I can also reach k plus 1 rung. That I am proving. That means, if this is true, I have proved this is true. Is it true one in the ante? Is it true one? Arthamaitunna amma. ఇది కూడా ట్రూ అవుతుంది అని నేను ప్రూవ్ చేస్తున్నాను. టు ప్రూవ్ దట్ ఐఎమ్ యాడింగ్ ఏ కే ప్లస్ వన్ ఆన్ బోత్ ద సైడ్స్ కే ప్లస్ వన్ ఐఎమ్ యాడింగ్ హియర్ క్లియర్ నౌ యూ విల్ గెట్ దిస్ ఈస్ ఈక్వల్ టు వాట్ సో దిస్ ఈస్ పి ఆఫ్ కే ప్లస్ వన్ the whole thing is, when you observe here, it is equal to P of K plus 1. So when you take the LCM as 2, then you will get 2 into K plus 1 by 2. So this is equal to, you take K plus 1 as common, then you will get K plus 1 into K plus 2 by 2. So when you observe here, this is same as the RHS part of your K plus 1. Is it clear? Therefore, I can say that whatever the given statement is, whatever is the given statement, that is 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus so on up to n is equal to n into n plus 1 by 2 is true for all n values. Is it clear for you all? Have you all understood, ma'am? If you want, you check it once.
Okay, for every node, they have written that lower bound value and upper bound value. So in DSP problem, the upper bound value.
Is it clear for you all?
Coming to the branch and board. Okay, coming to zero, that's the problem. So upper bound value is a, okay, this is the element in the band. So if the band is R field, okay, suppose the branch end is 9, I insert that element with the, I insert the
answer. Please let me know, ma. I'll discuss one more example. Shall I continue or shall I discuss in the next class? Please let me know first.
So we cannot insert that output. Right side is 5 and the output element is 9. We cannot insert that the total output weight into the. At that time we can write that fraction by 5 by 9 into the market. So here at that time we get that.
Yes, have you understood this example? What I explained now? Sum of n national numbers is equal to n into n plus 1 by 2. We have proved that is a valid statement or valid formula using the mathematical induction process. Are you there in the class? Okay. Shall I discuss one more? So, consider second example. You derive a statement or derive a formula for sum of the first n odd numbers or odd integers. You have to derive a formula for the sum of first n odd numbers, derived chasing tarvata, then check whether the derived formula is valid or not, whether the formula is valid or correct or using the mathematical induction. Is it clear, ma? You have to divide, the statement is given, to satisfy that statement, you have to divide a formula and using that mathematical induction, you have to prove whether that is valid or not. So, sum of n natural numbers means n odd numbers. So, sum of n odd numbers. First odd number is 1. What is the sum of 1? It is 1 only. Next, sum of 1 and 3. Because the next odd number is 3. 1 and 3. 4. Next odd number is 1, 3, 5. So, 1 plus 3 plus 5 is 9. Next odd number is 7. So, 1 plus 3 plus 5, 7 is equal to 10, 16. Next 1 plus 3 plus 5 plus 7 plus 9 is equal to 16, 21, 24, 25. Okay. So when you observe this, I can write this as 1 plus 3 plus 5 plus so on up to 2n minus 1. The last nil, 2n minus 1, the odd number. 2n is your even number, 2n minus 1 is the odd number. Clear? 2n is the even, 2n minus 1 is the odd. So I can write this as 1 square. 2 can be, 4 can be written as 2 square, 3 can be, 9 can be written as 3 square, this can be written as 4 square, 5 square. That means, next to what you will get? plus 11, if you add, you will get 6 square. That is 36 you will get. Clear? 25 plus 11 is 36 you will get. Next, you will get 7 square. That means sum of first n odd members, I can write it as n square. Clear? Now, I have derived the formula for sum of the first n odd numbers. I have derived the formula as n square. Now, using the mathematical induction, I have to prove this. So, what is the basis step? So, this involves two steps. First one is the basis step. What is the basis step? It should be true for P of 1. The formula. Whatever the formula, plus 2n minus 1 is equal to n square. This should be true for n equal to 1. So, that means for the first step, it should be true. For the first run, it should be true. First means what? You will have only one value. Only one odd number is equal to 1 square. That means 1 is equal to 1. It is true. So, basis step is true. Next, you will check for inductive step. Inductive step. So, inductive step means what? You will assume that it is true for P of K, and then you will prove that it is true for P of K plus 1. If it is true for P of K, then it is true for P of K plus 1, that you will assume. So P of K means you will get the formula as 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus so on up to 2K minus 1 is equal to K square. This is P of K, right? Next, you will consider P of K plus 1. If it is true, it should be true for P of K plus 1. That means if I can reach Kth rung, I can also reach K plus 1th rung. So on up to. So here, wherever you have K, there you just put 2K plus 1. So 2K plus 2 minus 1, that is 2K plus 1 you will get. Is equal to K plus 1 whole square. K plus 1 whole square. Right? So, now you have to prove that P of K plus 1 is true by using P of K. One way is what you can do? You consider P of K and you add 2K plus 1 to this P of K on both the sides. Why? Because we have 2K plus 1 here. Right? So, you can add this. Another way is
so, W1 is 2, W2 is 4, W3 is 6, W2 is 9.
One second. P of K means what? 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus. P of K means, this is your P of K. To this, you will add P of K plus 1, right? So, 2K minus 1 plus 2K plus 1 is equal to K plus 1 whole square. P of K plus 1 means, you will include Kth term, first term, second term, third term. Kth term is what? Kth term is 2K minus 1. This is K plus 1th term. So, it should be equal to K plus 1 whole square, right? So, this can be written as P of K, right? So, P of K so, this is P of K. I can write it as P of K plus 2K plus 1, right? And P of K is what? What is the value of P of K? It is K square. K square plus 2K plus 1. It is in the form of A square plus 2AB plus B square. I can write it as K plus 1. So, LHS is equal to RHS. Therefore, you can say that the formula what we have derived, that is 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus so on up to 2n minus 1 is equal to n square is valid. The formula is valid. Okay. Another way is you consider this P of K and to this P of K you add 2k plus 1 on both the sides. Then also you can get LHS is equal to RHS. So, in this way, by using this mathematical induction, by you considering the two steps, basis steps and inductive step, you can prove that the formula is valid. Is it clear for you all, ma'am? Have you all understood? Have you all understood?
So based on that,
wait for a while. I'll take the attendance. Meanwhile, if you have any doubts, you please let me know.